Where else are you gonna go to hear music like that? All right, last time we were together, I'll get this thing out of the way. We're good, right? The last time we were together, I went over the first angel's message. It was a hard message. You know, it's a judgment message. Today is not a lot easier. It's the second angel's message. But these are the reasons this church was called into existence, brothers and sisters. If you turn your Bibles to Revelation 14, 14 and verse 1. The title of this sermon is The Second Angel and the Power of the Fourth. I'm going to read from Revelation 14, 1 to 8. Okay? Everybody there? And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his Father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation, and kindred, and tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven, and earth, and the sea, and the fountains of water. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Do you hear that there? This Babylon is mentioned six times in Revelation, okay? When you go up there to verse 4, it says, These are they which are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. They are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits of God, first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. But then when we come down here into this 8, it says, And therefore another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine. What's this wine represent? The doctrines, right? Of the wrath of her fornication. Well, why does the Bible say fornication?
Spiritual unfaithfulness.
Spiritual unfaithfulness. So there was a good standing there at one time, wasn't there? But she has slipped. She has fallen. It says, is fallen. It says it twice. It says it twice many times in the Bible, if you study this out. If it says is fallen, it presupposes that at one time she stood, correct? Because you got to stand to fall. You can't fall if you're already laying down. In Isaiah 14:12, Satan says, God says, How are thou fallen from heaven? How are thou fallen from heaven? Where did Satan come from? In good standing, right? He was Lucifer in heaven, wasn't he? We got this same fallen going on. Going your own way, a law unto yourself. That's what this is. That's what this fallen is, okay? How art thou cut down to the ground which did weaken the nations? This is Satan's fall. Pollution corrupts, brothers and sisters. It makes one unholy. Let's turn to Genesis. We all know where that book is, right? Genesis 1 and 31. Y'all there? And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good, and the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thus the heaven and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. Do you hear this? God had made everything, right? The sixth day, and now he's going to rest in the seventh, right? Isn't that what the Bible says?
Yeah.
So he has rested, the Bible says. And then what's verse 3 say? And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that he had, this is past tense, correct? Rested, right? From all his work which he had created and made. You see a significance here? God didn't declare it holy and sanctify it and everything beforehand. He lived with Adam and Eve. What happened at the end of the sixth day? Weren't they created? Adam and Eve? So what's the first thing that they do? They rest. Why is that so significant? What's God trying to prove here? What is God trying to show? That he, right, has it all taken care of. What are they to do? Rest in him. But people today are accused of being legalists because they rest. Because they do what God says. You're working your way to heaven. It seems demonic to me. Anyways, and 3. Let's go down to chapter 3. Verse 1 and 2. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? What is he doing to her? Is he pulling her right in? She's focused on this tree now, right? What should she have done? Should she have entered into dialogue with Satan?
No.
What did Jesus do when he was tempted by Satan?
It is written. That he had Satan.
It is written. It is written. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. Why did she ever even spoke to him? She had already sinned in her heart by simply going. The desire was already there. As far as I'm concerned, she was hypnotized. Let's turn to Revelation 17. Revelation 17. Revelation 17 and verse 5. And upon her forehead, everybody's there? I'm not going to waste any time. We're going to just go today. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. In my Bible, that's all in capitals. Yours too? You suppose there's some significance there? Okay. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the seven heads and 10 horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they beheld the beast that was and is not and yet is. Brothers and sisters, the Tower of the Babel was the very first Babylon. Okay? The Tower of Babel is built on unbelief and defiance. That's what it is. It's unbelief and defiance. That's what represents Babylon. It's an attempt of gaining heaven by your own way. Babel means the gateway of the gods. Did you know that? The gateway of the gods. Let's turn to Genesis 10. I got you going back and forth. At least you're just easy books to find, right? Genesis 10. Genesis 10 and verse 8. Verse 8 says, "And Cush begot Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom was Babel." Babel. So Cush here was the son of Ham in verse 6. And in verse 8, Nimrod, it shows, was the son of Cush. That would make him the great-grandson of Noah. Right? So why would he build the Tower of Babel? He had it direct that God would not flood the earth again. Did he not? You see how this Babel means going your own way? The second Babylon, brothers and sisters, was Hammurabi. Hammurabi, you look this stuff up for yourself. Okay, he was in 1750 BC, I think around Abraham's time. There's somewhat overlap there. He wrote a similar law to God's law, but not the same. Similar, but not the same. Doesn't John 10, I think it is, say that Jesus is the gate, right? John 14, 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Are you hearing me here? There is no other way, okay? Jesus Christ, period. Brothers and sisters, when you have a similar law that's like but not the same, have you heard of a catechism? The third Babylon is Nebuchadnezzar's, correct? God used this Babylon to discipline his people. Let's turn to Jeremiah. Jeremiah. Jeremiah and 51. Jeremiah 51 and verse 6. "Flee out of the midst of Babylon and deliver every man his soul. Be not cut off in her iniquity, for this is the time of the Lord's vengeance. He will render unto her a recompense." Skip down to 26. "And they shall not take of thee a stone for a corner, nor a stone for foundations, but thou shalt be desolate forever, saith the Lord." And in the 37, "And Babylon shall become heaps, a dwelling place for dragon, an astonishment, and a hissing, without an inhabitant." After God was done correcting his people, what did he do to Babylon? Correct. The fourth Babylon, which is Rome, papal and pagan. Okay? That's the fourth Babylon. we turn our Bibles to 1 Peter, church that is at Babylon, elected together with you, saluteth you. This is Peter speaking, and how can he say Babylon if Babylon has been done away with? This is code for Rome, you realize. Revelation 14:8. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. 18, Revelation 18, 1 and 2. You get there, say amen. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mighty with a strong voice, saying, no, wait a minute. Did he cry with a whimper?
No.
Oh, it says a strong voice. Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. When we come to God's house, brothers and sisters, are we merely here to have an exercise in academics? Or are we seeking to be sanctified by the Word of God? Is there any other way? When we preach the truth as it is in God's Word, there are only two camps, brothers and sisters. Two camps. There is no other camps. Why is it that I can say that? What happened in 1844? Pardon me? What was the great disappointment? Why? What did they miss? They missed what was happening, right? There was a cleansing that was happening, right? But they thought it was going to be the earth. But it was Jesus moving from the holy place to the most holy place, right? You had Babylon teaching all these things that were wrong. You had reformists coming up, right? Teaching that this was false doctrine and we don't live with tradition and all these things, right? We follow Jesus and the Bible, correct? Did they continue to go down that road or did they follow the beast? They followed the beast. That's why I say there's two camps. If you turn to Luke 6 and 26, it says, woe unto you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. Woe. Is this what we seek? Is all men to speak well of us? Why aren't we doing the job that we are called to do? Why do we join into ecumenical conferences and be involved in all these things? Why do we, well, you ought to tone it down, brother. You can't say it how it really is because you might upset somebody. Well, you know what? I don't want to look somebody in the eye someday and they say to me, you knew? You knew? Brother, you knew and you watched me die? How do we feel as Adventists with this last day message? Are we alive with this message? Why are we still here? Why are we still here? Because we're comfortable with the other churches. We're not speaking the truth. But we got to be friends with everybody, don't we? Just love everybody. Isn't that the way it's supposed to be? Just love. Love, love, love. What about Jonah? How about Jonah? What message did he have?
A strong one.
Well, maybe God should have said to Jonah, you should go there and have a study and get everybody together, you know, and love on everybody. Is that what he did? No. God said, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for the wickedness has come up before me. The wickedness has come up before me. Is there a place by that scripture that you can see where God finally is exhausted of his patience with people that will absolutely refuse? Second Peter 3:9. Second Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, were not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Amen.
Isn't that God?
Amen.
But what if they just won't go? What if he's done everything he can do, and they won't listen? A loving Father. And Ezra, I'm just going to turn there quick, you guys don't have to. In Ezra 9:1-2, it says, now when these things were done, the princes came to me, saying, the people of Israel and the priests and the Levites have not separated themselves from the people of the lands, doing according to their abominations, even of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites. For they have taken of their daughters for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy seed have mingled themselves with the people of those lands. Yea, the hand of the princes and the ruler hath been chief in this transgress. Who are the people following? Who should they be following? The Lord Jesus Christ in this word, right? In Nehemiah, the one book over, in 9:30. Yet many elders did not, didst thou forbear them, and testify against them by the Spirit in thy prophets. Yet would they not give ear, therefore gavest thou them into the hand of the people of the lands. Nevertheless, for thy great mercy's sake, thou didst not utterly consume them, nor forsake them, for they are a gracious and merciful God. We do serve a gracious and merciful God, don't we?
Amen.
Ephesians 5:11 says, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather what? Expose or reprove them, right? I went by a church, and I'm not trying to pick on churches, okay? But I was driving up the road, and I went by this church, and the name of the church was Club Zion Community Church. Is that cool? It's a club. What about Disney? What about Disney movies? Everybody's so comfortable with everything these days. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about sorcery and all that stuff? Do you know any Disney movies that don't have sorcery in them and all that stuff? How is it that we have become so comfortable with the world that we don't look separate from the world? How can we finish this work if we're not focused on the things that we need to be focused on, brothers and sisters? When you stand against apostasy, don't expect those of your own faith to stand with you. Okay? Don't expect them to stand with you. I want you to turn to 2 Timothy. I'm getting closing up here. 2 Timothy. In 2 Timothy 4 and 16, it says, "At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge." Who is this speaking?
Paul.
And who's he standing before? This is Nero. This is Rome, brothers and sisters. Nobody, Paul says, stood with him. Nobody. The catechism, my friends, these aren't easy things to say. And I'm not talking about people, okay? I'm talking about systems here. Systems. The catechism abolishes the second commandment. That's how they brought all the... I don't even want to go there. Changes the fourth from the Sabbath to Sunday. Divides the tenth so that it can stay similar. Right? Teaches the immortal soul, purgatory, penance, priests forgiving sins. You walk into a two-apartment sanctuary divided by a curtain where you ask forgiveness from a man. You ever stop and think about that? A little sanctuary? Everywhere God has the genuine, the devil will have a counterfeit. Turn your Bibles to Matthew 15. Matthew 15 and verse 6. "And honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. They have, yea, made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition." By your tradition, you have made God's commandment of none effect. These are Jesus' words. These aren't my words, brothers and sisters. These are Jesus' words. In Isaiah 30, in verse 10, "Which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things." Prophecy deceits. Tickle our itching ears, the New Testament would say, doesn't it? In Revelation, in closing, let's turn to Revelation 13. In 15, "And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name." Didn't we talk about a mark that God gives? But there's another mark here, isn't there? We read about that in Revelation 14. Brothers and sisters, in closing, I want to read you something. But I just want to say that these things that I say sometimes are hard, but I want you to know when I preach from this pulpit, it's going to be a present truth message. And if I'm not preaching present truth, I don't belong in this pulpit. I'm going to read from you, and I'm not going to tell you what this is, but anybody who really wants to know, I'm going to talk to me afterwards, and I'll tell you what.